Happy Sabbath. I'm Elder Robert Johnson, and I want to welcome you to our Sabbath School summary for today. We've been looking at the quarter that's entitled The Promises of God and the Everlasting Covenant. Last week, we looked at the covenant with respect to Noah and future generations. Today, we're looking at another Bible hero. That is Abram. So before we begin, let's have a word of prayer and we'll move forward into our lesson study. Father in heaven, once again, we thank you for the privilege of studying your word. We invite you now to come speak to our minds and our hearts according to our needs. In Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. So before we start, let's take a look at our memory text for the day. And it is found in Genesis chapter 17, verse 7. And it reads, I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your descendants after you. One of the things that we talked about in our very first session was this idea that there seem to be these patterns that surface in the discussions of covenants. The first thing we see is that the covenant is always God seeking after the man, seeking after the person, seeking after the people. It is never the people seeking after God. It's the old idea of the shepherd looking for the sheep, never the sheep looking for the shepherd. So God always initiates the conversation. He initiates the contact. The second thing that we see is that in this contact, God gives the man the instructions as to what needs to be done in order to move forward. And then thirdly, we see that God makes a promise. And everything that man needs in order to experience the fulfillment of that promise, God provides that. So God makes the contact, God gives the instruction, and then God makes the promise and gives everything that's needed to fulfill that promise or experience the fulfillment of that promise. And that's basically it. The idea of the covenant is something that goes way back to the Adam and Eve experience. God made the promise to Adam, I'm going to give you all that you see, all that you've that's been created. You're essentially going to have dominion. All you have to do is simply don't eat of a certain tree and you'll have everlasting life. That's a covenant. That's a relationship. Of course, we know that sin crept into the picture and it has brought us to the other stories that we see in the book of Genesis that will be unfolding here over the next few weeks. As we begin to realize that God has made these promises, we begin to see that God has a purpose. And again, that purpose is just to bring us back to where Adam and Eve were originally in that face-to-face eternal communion and relationship with God. Today, we're going to look at Abram, and we'll see at least the first part of Abram's journey. We'll look a little bit at it next week as well. Today, the journey begins to focus on this idea of names and what names mean. When God first spoke to Abram, he introduces himself. He says, I am the Lord. Our Sabbath School lesson study points out that he uses this term Yahweh. And the Yahweh term is God talking about himself. It talks about the eternity of God, God of the past and the present and the future. It talks about the God who has no one before him and no one after him. So this word, this name that God uses for himself says something to Abram. But then we go on and we see that God has made this promise to Abram. He begins by saying, I am the Lord who has brought you out of this land of Ur. It's always been interesting to me that it's very similar in language to the language that's used in the beginning of the Ten Commandments, the beginning of this covenant that the Lord speaks with the children of Israel at Mount Sinai, where he simply begins in Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, and he says, "So I am the Lord that brought thee out of the land of Egypt." So again, we see these patterns, these similar languages in God talking with man and introducing and offering this covenant, man to enter into this covenant relationship with him. So the name of God surfaces. And in this covenant, he says, you're going to be the father of many nations. Look at the stars of the sky. Can you count them? No, we can't count them. Well, your seed is going to be like the stars of the sky. Abraham at this time is 75 years old. Sure enough, he has this promise. Sure enough, he has his instructions. As we said, he and his family leave the land of Ur, and they are now following God's direction. 15 years pass. Over this 15 years, Abram and Sarai are realizing we have no children. How are we going to be the father of nations if we have no children? And so they decide to help God out. They decide to help God fulfill his promise. And you know the story where Sarai gives her handmaid to Abram, and through that relationship, they have Ishmael. So now Abram is feeling, I now have a son. I'm going to indeed be the father of nations through this son. 15 years later, Abram is now 90 years old. And we begin to see he's thinking that everything is okay. But then we see God come back to him again. And in this verse, in Genesis chapter 17 and verse 1, he introduces himself again. God introduces himself again. And this time the name that he uses is El Shaddai. El Shaddai is a word that is translated God Almighty or the Almighty God. And the question that's asked in the Sabbath school lesson is, so why would God use this introduction, this name, at this time? Well, one of the reasons is that God is about to share with Abram and Sarai a new statement of the old covenant, of the old promise. He says, still, you're going to be the father of many nations. And Abram says, hey, I've got a son. You know, we're already working on that. God says, no, you're going to have a son through Sarai. And this is so incredible because now Abram is 99 years old, Sarai is 90 years old, and this is so amazing until the Bible literally says in Genesis chapter 17, read that story, that Abram falls over and he laughs at God. It's just so amazing. So God has to use this term God Almighty because he's getting ready to do something with and for and through Abram and Sarai that nobody else could do but God. Now, this is where the name thing comes in again, because we see that God has been introducing himself using these various names, and these names mean something. The first name, the Yahweh name, is the God that is just everlasting, past, present, future. The second name, the El Shaddai, the Almighty God, is the God who can do anything. And with him, nothing is impossible. And at 99 and 90 years old, Abram and Sarah have to realize that it's going to take a God who can do the impossible if indeed the promise that God is making to them is going to be fulfilled. So he uses this name. But he not only uses this name for himself, but he also now changes the name of Abram to Abraham. The Abram name means father is exalted. So Abram's original name was an exalting of him. But now Abraham means that the father of the multitude. So God changed the name of Abram to Abraham so that first, the person who's receiving the name change can see himself differently. God changes the name so that Abram can now see himself differently now as Abraham. Secondly, he changes his name so that people who are calling Abram by this new name can see Abraham differently. So the person sees himself differently and other people see himself, see him differently. So this name changes the whole relationship of Abram to the way he's seeing himself and the way other people see and think about him. I've been playing with this and realizing that God actually has naming rights, and we're seeing the naming rights of God begin to play out here. If you play it back, we see that God named Adam. So he had the naming rights of the man that he created, named Adam. But then he gave Adam naming rights. Naming rights are interesting. So, you know, we have stadiums and buildings around towns, and various entities have decided that they want naming rights. We want to name the stadium or name the building after us. The name is supposed to represent the character of the person or the character of the entity. I'm sure you have similar places in your town where you live. So naming rights are important. So God had naming rights and he named Adam. But then he gave Adam, because he made Adam in the image of God, in the mind of God, he gave Adam naming rights for everything else. So in the story of Adam, we see that he allowed Adam to name all the animals. And we see that he brought the animals to him to see what he would call them. So Adam had naming rights. Later on in Genesis chapter 3, 17, I believe it is, he actually named his wife, gave his wife the name Eve. So Adam had naming rights. So we see this naming rights thing way back at the very beginning in the Bible. Here, we see that God has naming rights, and he has now changed Abram's name to Abraham so that the mindset of Abraham would be changed, and the mindset of people who called Abraham by this new name would be changed. But the covenant remained the same. The promise remained the same. It was simply the approach to the promise and the way that Abram thought about the promise that was changed. So as we see in this lesson study, God gave him a new name. And the new name reflected his new thinking about what God could do and who he was going to be. Oh, Lord, we know that we need new names. And in fact, we're told that in Isaiah that we would be given new names. This is Isaiah chapter 62 and verse 2, that we would be given new names. So God has naming rights over us to call us of what it is that we're going to be. Revelation also says the same thing. God always calls us by what he sees us being, not by who we are. God has a promise to fulfill to each one of us. And as I think about this story, I begin to realize that the tests of faith that we see these various characters going through is really to prepare them to receive the fulfillment of the promise. The test of faith is designed to prepare them to receive the fulfillment of the promise. As we continue our study on next week and we look more at the Abraham story, we see how God continues to walk with him along this journey in order to fulfill the promise that he has made. Let us pray. Father in heaven, once again, we thank you for what you've done, what you're going to do for us. Keep us now, Lord, we pray, as we continue to keep our hand in yours, as we continue to focus our mind and our attention on you, that by beholding, we become changed into who and what you'd have us to be. In Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. be blessed.
Hello, friends. I'm Anissa Johnson, and I would like to welcome you to the Spirit and Truth Sabbath Morning Worship Service. This has been a challenging week for our world, our nation, and even for us individually. So thankfully, God created the Sabbath so that we can step back from our toils and focus on Him. It is medicine for our wounded hearts. I'd like to thank Elder Johnson for his review of the Sabbath School lesson, where we are studying God's covenants. Today's speaker for the hour is Pastor Peter Neary, who will be studying with us about the seven last plagues. His sermon is titled, The Gospel and the Seven Last Plagues. So be sure to have your Bibles at hand so that we may feast on the Word. God is a wonderful God, and there is a blessing here for us. So come, let us worship the Lord together.
Praise the Lord, young people. I'm Pastor Ryan Johnson, and for today's little story and lesson, I'm going to talk about precipitation. Now, because you're so smart, I'm sure you already know what precipitation is, but just in case, precipitation is when water falls out of the sky. It evaporates as vapor into the sky, it makes clouds, and then it falls back down. Different types of precipitation fall in different places on Earth and at different times, like when it's cold. Frozen water may fall from the sky, and in the spring, when it's warmer, lots of wet water may fall. Now, some kids have never seen certain kinds of precipitation. The type of precipitation that most people know about is rain. But even so, in some places, it almost never rains. And in fact, though it rains every now and then here in Las Vegas, my own kids, Carson and Jalen, had never seen a real downpour of rain until they were 6 and 7 years old. Because when I was growing up in North Carolina, it rained at least once every few days, and sometimes for an entire week. And when it rains hard, it sounds like a lot of people clapping, or sounds like your mom frying something tasty in a pan of oil. Now, sometimes it rains, but it's really cold and the rain freezes into ice on the way down. And when that happens, you get all these little tiny balls of ice that fall onto the ground. And you can hear it going tick, tick, tick as it hits the ground or as it hits your window. Have you ever seen that? That's called sleet. And sometimes when the air pressure is low, like in a storm, that makes it cold, and the water in the air can freeze and clump together into big pieces of ice. And when that falls, we call that hail. And I don't know if you've ever been in a hailstorm, but that can be pretty scary. I can tell you some stories when we have time. Now, when hail hits the ground, it goes thump, thump, thump. But there's another kind of precipitation that some people have seen a lot, but many people have never seen. Depends on where you live. Now, this kind of falling water is so light that when it hits the ground, it doesn't make a sound at all. It's so quiet. You know what it is? Well, here's another hint. It can be a whole lot of fun. That's right. Snow. Let's see if I can make it snow in here. Ah, I got skills. You know I do. Now, when I was a kid, we would get out of school if it snowed, and we called those snow days. Those are wonderful days. And when I grew up, I was a math teacher for a while, and let me tell you, grown-ups are just as excited about snow days as the kids are, if they're teachers. Now, my mom is a teacher, and I can remember her looking outside the window when they said it might snow, just looking at the sky, hoping for one snowflake so we could all get out of school. It was like having a mini vacation. Those were good times. Building snow people, having snowball fights, sledding down the hill into Brother Holmes's yard, and then running away before he came out and yelled at us. But that's because we lived in the foothills of the Carolinas, where snow was not a regular thing. Some kids live in places where it never, ever snows, and they've never seen it. Have you ever watched videos of kids playing in snow for the first time in their life, or dogs or cats? I love it. I love to see that. Now, some kids see snow all the time. It's everywhere. Kids in Michigan, kids in New York, and they don't get out for snow. They don't have snow days. And they think we're pretty crazy for having snow days. There are many lessons we can learn from snow. Like, here's a good one. Every snowflake, did you know this? Every snowflake is different. No two snowflakes are alike. Just like you are unlike anyone else on earth. Or here's a lesson. God can wash us whiter than snow, which means he will remove the dirt of sin from our lives. And snow that doesn't have dirt in it is white, just like water without dirt is clear. But here's the lesson I want to share today. Snow is so light that when a flake falls upon your shoulder, unless you feel the cold, you can't even tell that it fell on you. Each snowflake is like the featheriest of feathers, the brush of butterfly wings, so light and so soft. But you know what? Even though it's light, over time, snow can build up. It can build up higher and higher and heavier, and soon that light and fluffy butterfly wing of snow can cover all the cars and doors and houses so that you can't escape it on your own. It can become dangerous. It can become an avalanche. You know, Satan tempts us like that, doesn't he? He says, hey, kids, smoke this cigarette or listen to this song with bad curse words in it. It's just a little thing. It's just a light thing. You'll hardly even notice. And then he comes back and says, that wasn't so bad, was it? Let's do it again. Yay. And each little time you give in to temptation, it can pile up more and more. And before we know it, we're caught under an avalanche of trouble and addiction. You know, the Bible says in Psalms chapter 37, verses 26 and 27, depart from evil, no matter how little it seems, and do good, no matter how little it seems, and dwell forevermore. For the Lord loves judgment and forsakes not his saints. That's you. They are preserved forever, but the seed of the wicked shall be cut off. That's that avalanche we're talking about. So do well, young people, and run from even the tiniest of evil. And if you are already caught under an avalanche, Psalms 3 says, I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. Amen. So throw your hands up to God, and he will rescue you from under your sins. Isn't that great? Doesn't that make you feel good? Me too. All right, well, that's all for today. Flee from evil, young people. And as always, be encouraged. Love you guys.
Hi, my name's Carson. Thank you for worshiping with us at Spirit and Truth. We love ministering and spreading the gospel just like Jesus told us to do. But it's not always easy, so any support from you would be awesome. Thank you, and God bless you for your generosity. Now, come on, let us get ready for Jesus.
Friends, it's time for prayer. And you know, in my mind, the thought occurred to me, one of the simplest texts in the Bible, almost as simple as Jesus wept, is in 1 Thessalonians, where it says, pray without ceasing. And so we're going to pray. We're going to petition the throne of God. We're going to ask Him to divinely intervene in our behalf. For many of the things that you're facing, I'm facing, can't handle, but God can. All things are possible with God. And we want to pray, as you well know, for Pastor Ryan, who was diagnosed with double pneumonia. And we want to see him quickly recover. And so please keep him in your prayers, if you would. And he continues to go under go through further tests. But the good God of heaven has even made him stronger today. He told me, I'm breathing better. And I was really glad to hear that. So my friend, what do you have on your mind and heart? Who do you have in your family that needs prayer? A friend, a neighbor, a relative. Well, we're going to present all of these before the Lord right now. So let us pray. Father, what a privilege prayer is. For we come into direct contact with the King of the universe. And Lord, I can't even get a hold of the mayor of my city I live in, because they have gatekeepers, won't allow you to get through that gate. They're too busy, they're too important, but not the God of heaven. Oh, how we thank you. So we ask for forgiveness of our sins, Lord. For if we're going to present any requests before you, we need to be right with you. Lord, forgive us for our sins. And then we ask for the Holy Spirit, the gift from heaven to replace Jesus on earth, the one who can bring to us in contact with you. And this way, Lord, we can also be more like you. And now, Father, you know our hearts and minds. You know the things we're facing. You know we're praying for Pastor Ryan Johnson as he's getting rid of the water in both of his lungs, Lord. And the fact we praise you that he's breathing better. But I only mention it again because, Father, this is the hope we have for those who we want to bring before you right now. For if you can take care of him in such a serious matter, you can take care of those we love, those we're concerned about, those we live with or by, those we may work with, those who are church members of ours. Lord, right now I can say that there's 6 people I specifically know that are in the ICU on respirators because of COVID that continues. And Lord, we have prayed together. And every time I pray and others pray, we get a confidence that we didn't have before we prayed. So, Lord, intervene divinely for each one of the requests that are being presented to you right now, including mine. And then, Father, help us to remember when the answer comes to give you the praise, the honor, the worship, and the glory you deserve. And we thank you for always hearing, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Well, God bless you, friends. God will answer our prayers. Well, friends, you know we've been going through the heart of Revelation for a while now, and we're going to continue yet today, but we're getting close to the end. And I want you to know that the title of today's sermon is The Gospel and the Seven Last Plagues. But before I get to the gospel and the seven last plagues, let me do a brief review of what we did 2 weeks ago. And so take your Bibles, if you would, and turn with me to Revelation, the 18th chapter. And we'll do this review here. Starting at verse 1, here's what it says. After these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon, the great is fallen, and has become the dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquity. Wow, what a declaration we find in Revelation 18 that we covered 2 weeks ago. And I want you to notice that, if you don't mind, this would be the fourth angel that has a message that is very final. And what do I mean? Well, in Revelation, the 14th chapter, we found what we called the three angels' messages, and we covered all of those. But let me just review this. The first angel, here's what it says, Revelation 14:6. Then I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice. And then his message. But in Revelation 14, verse 8, and another angel saying, and then in Revelation 9, then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice. And so we see a succession of three angels. But when we get over to Revelation, the 18th chapter, notice there's a fourth angel. After this, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his splendor. Well, notice that it says, he cried mightily with a loud voice. In fact, in the Greek, it literally translates, he cries with a strong, great voice. And what does he cry? He cries, Babylon, the great, is fallen and has become the dwelling place of demons, a prison of every foul spirit, a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. Friends, that's the second angel's message, remember? The second angel said, Babylon the Great has fallen and fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, in a heightened fashion, that message is repeated to us in Revelation 18, and we are to understand this is the final warning. And I want you to notice the degree of degradation that has occurred to Babylon the Great. For it was in the second angel, she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. When we get to Revelation 18, it clearly tells us, because it's become the dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. Well, I'm going to clarify that in a second, but I want you to remember, Babylon are the fallen churches that are actually, in the name of Jesus, teaching false prophecy. And when we get to Revelation, we're getting to the final warning. And so what's interesting here is I'm going to read from Isaiah 13, verse 20, 21, and 22. Isaiah 13, 20, 21, and 22. And in these verses is the destruction of Babylon, literal Babylon, back in the days of Israel. And you will see that here in the second angel's message, Babylon has fallen, but especially here in 18, it's using the imagery of the destruction of literal Babylon, describing the destruction of spiritual Babylon. And here's what it says. It will never be inhabited again, nor will it be settled from one generation to generation. Nor will the Arabians pitch tents there. Nor will the shepherds make their sheepfold there. But wild beasts of the desert will lie there, and their houses will be full of owls. Ostriches will dwell there, and wild goats with capers there. The hyenas will howl in their citadels, the jackals in their pleasant palaces. Her time is near to come, and her days will not be prolonged. And so you see the reference to all these wild beasts and even birds. And it described the destruction of literal Babylon. And here we find spiritual Babylon will also be destroyed. In fact, I want to read this to you. Notice that this language was borrowed from the description of literal Babylon's destruction. And I'm going to read to you a comment on this from Albert Barnes's New Testament commentary. Listen to this. In verse Isaiah 14:23, it says that it will be the possession for the bitterns. The idea is that of utter desolation. And the meaning here is that spiritual Babylon, papal Rome, will be reduced to a state of utter destruction resembling that of real Babylon. It is the papal see represented under the image of the city and having its seat there at Rome, that it will be destroyed as utterly as the Babylon of old. That will become as odious and as loathsome and detestable as literal Babylon, the abode of monsters, is there. But notice also, it says, because you're asked, wait a minute, this is pretty severe. Well, why? Look, all the nations, verse 3, have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. Friends, nations, kings, merchants, that covers everybody on earth. And that is why this utter destruction will come, because the influence of papal Rome, the false doctrines from the fallen churches, has pervaded everything just before Jesus returns. In fact, it's reminiscent to me. If you remember in Revelation 13:3, we were introduced to a beast that was described there. And that beast, we found out that the Protestant reformers claimed that beast, and we do too, was papal Rome. And notice that in Revelation 13:3, it says, all the world marveled and followed the beast. And so we see that in Revelation 18, it's describing what's going to happen in the very end and why it's going to happen. And then the announcement comes from the fourth angel, the announcement that is so important and timely for us right now. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, "Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities." Oh Lord, in my Bible, friends, in my Bible, it says that God will remember our sins no more. He'll put them in the deepest part of the sea and then put a sign out that says, "No fishing." But in this fourth angel's message, friends, God has remembered her iniquity. They have reached to heaven. This is the end point. It's come to that. So he's saying to his sincere believers in Jesus Christ, it's now time to come out of Babylon. You can no longer remain there and not be guilty of her sins, it says, but also receive her plagues. Wow, plagues. She receives the plagues, the seven last plagues, talked about in Revelation 15 and 16. Ah, but before we look at those plagues, and remember, we're looking at the gospel in the seven last plagues. Where is the good news in that the wrath of God being poured out on those who have the mark of the beast and worship the beast in his image? Well, I want to divert back to the very first verse we read, in which it said, the whole earth will be illuminated with his glory. Remember? After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the whole earth was illuminated with his glory. Wow, what possibly could that be? And by the way, an angel is a messenger. A messenger from God. And of course, by the way, the churches, the pastors, and the members are messengers. They have received the good news, the gospel. They're to share it with other people. But notice it says, the earth was illuminated with his glory. Now, whose glory would an angel represent to the earth? That's Jesus. It isn't the angel's glory, for God alone is glorious. And so this angel comes down with this message, "Come out of her, my people," displays a brilliant spreading of the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, him dying for our sins. It illuminates the whole earth. What is that? Well, I'm going to take you to the Old Testament. I'm going to take you to Joel, the second chapter. Joel, the second chapter, here's what the prophet Joel said about the last days. "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also on my manservants and on my maidservants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. And I will show wonders in heaven and in earth, blood, fire, pillars of smoke." Joel predicts that in the last days, there's going to be an outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will affect every one of the believers. And I clearly see that this prediction by Joel is exactly what is referred to in Revelation, the 18th chapter. And by the way, when we talked about Revelation 13, the two beasts of Revelation 13, and the terrible work they would do, You may wonder what would cause them to do this. And let me read, do this. What is do this? Revelation 13, 15. And he granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many who would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. And then it says in verse 16, he caused all, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark in their right hand and in their forehead, and that no one may buy or sell except those that have the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. What would cause them to respond that way? The outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And friends, you've heard of the early rain, or I should say, what happened in Acts, the second chapter, when the fledgling church was left without their Savior, spent 10 days together praying, and all of a sudden the Spirit was poured out. And each one of the 120 in the upper room, men and women, began to speak in foreign languages the gospel of Jesus. And a group that was called in chapter 2 of Acts, Galileans, uneducated, literally broke, having all the religious leaders opposed to their leader, Jesus, and their teachings. The Holy Spirit is poured out and the church grows worldwide, friends. Well, I want you to know that started the church. And the same thing is going to happen at the end. Why? Because before the harvest, there has to be a rain. And that rain is predicted by Joel. And it is told what it's like in Revelation 18. Causing the beast to pass a decree that whoever will not worship the beast or the image, as it said, would be killed. You go, oh, not in America. That can't happen. Well, it happened on the European continent all during the Middle Ages. Revelation predicts it'll happen again. And so, friends, Revelation 18 tells us, come out of her, my people, because Babylon has gone too far. And when the right moment comes, the plagues will be poured out. So let's look at the seven last plagues as found in Revelation 15 and 16. Let's look for this gospel that I'm referring to. Good news. Where can that possibly be? Because this is the wrath of God. Revelation 15, 1. And then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having seven last plagues. For in them the wrath of God is complete. And now I'm going to go to 16, verse 1, and let's look at these. And then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, go, pour out your bowls of wrath, the wrath of God on the earth. And verse 2 says, so the first angel went and poured out his bowl upon the earth. And a foul, loathsome sore came upon the men who had the mark of the beast and those who worshiped him in the image. Now, friends, I want you to notice that in the last days, you're either going to have the mark or you're not. You got to make a choice. That's why Revelation 18 says, come out of her, my people. You can't stay in there and be forgiven. You'll be identified with their sin. Not only that, they're going to force you to comply to their teaching and their ways. That's what Revelation teaches. And so these plagues are poured out on the people who have the mark of the beast and those who worshiped his image. Well, look at the second one. Verse 3, and then the second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it became blood as of a dead man, and every living creature in the sea died. And then the third angel, verse 4, poured out his bowl on the river of springs of water, and they became blood. And I heard an angel of the waters saying, You are righteous, O Lord, the one who is and who was and who is to be, because you have judged these things. For they have shed the bloods of saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink, for it is their just due. And I heard another angel from the altar saying, even so, Lord God Almighty, true and righteous are your judgments. Where is the good news? First of all, friends, if the thought of the seven last plagues horrifies you, first of all, I want you to know, in the third plague, angels of heaven who have sided with God declare that his judgments are fair and just. In fact, it says that you are true and righteous in all your judgments. Friends, I want you to note that. This is the good news. In fact, here's the next bit of good news. Let's go to the fourth angel. And then the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and power was given to him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God, who has power over the plagues. And they did not repent or give him glory. What? Are you kidding me? If these plagues are being poured out on you by the fourth one, what would you be doing? I'd be on my knees saying, Lord, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I didn't mean to do this. I don't want this to happen. And so on the third plane, the angels declare that Jesus is true and righteous for these judgments. Heavenly beings who never sin recognize that this is appropriate under the circumstances. Then we get to the fourth one, and it says here that they blasphemed the name of God who has power over these plagues, and they did not repent or give him glory. The gospel, friends. Nothing will change their mind. The plagues were poured out, first of all, so that God could show his preeminence over everything. By the way, the plagues that were poured out on Egypt, every time one fell, all the people saw that Moses' God was greater than their God. Yet they continued to rebel against him. At least Pharaoh did. And so again, they're being poured out in the last days. By the way, this hasn't happened yet. We haven't got to the point where they're saying to you, either you worship the beast or I'll kill you. But friends, when that happens, you have better had changed sides already. Because the next thing that occurs is the outpouring of the seven last plagues, proving to the universe and now to you and I that God is fair and just. Nothing would cause them to repent. Well, let's see if this is really true. Let's look at verse 10. And then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast. His kingdom became full of darkness, and they gnawed their teeth because of pain. Verse 11. And they blasphemed God of heaven because of their pain and their sores, and did not repent of their deeds. Wow, friends, I am telling you, this is incredible to me. we see that God is clearly indicating to us that no matter what, they're not going to change. Their character is fixed. And God isn't being mean and nasty. Instead, what he's doing is being a judge and showing us clearly that he is true and righteous, as the angels declared. Well, we got two more plagues. Let's go to the sixth one. This is very interesting. Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its waters dried up, so that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. That happens to be the plague right there, the first verse, 12. But then there's a prelude, so to speak. In between the sixth and seventh is a pronouncement. And that pronouncement tells us how we got where we are. Look what verse 13 says. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. The unholy Trinity, friends. And they are spirits of demons performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and the whole world to gather them to battle of the great day of God Almighty. And by the way, let me tell you, I got to stop even though I'm not done. Now we see why we're in this situation we're in. Because there was an unholy Trinity that got together and forced their will upon the whole world and threatened them that either you do it our way or you're dead. And notice it says to gather them all together to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Now, I just want to say this. I'm going to read on. I'm going to say this. The battle of the great day of God Almighty, the great day of God Almighty is the second coming of Jesus Christ. You know what this says? That well before the plagues were starting to be poured out, they were amassing the troops on their side for the purpose of fighting against the coming of Jesus Christ. How? By fighting against Jesus' believers on earth. And then it goes on to say this in verse 15, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keep his garments, lest they walk naked and see his shame. And verse 16 says, and they gathered them together to a place called in Hebrew Armageddon. Now, friends, we have the choice of watching and keeping our garments so we don't walk naked and they don't see our shame. And of course, the garments is the righteousness of Jesus Christ given us by faith through his grace. Or we can be those who are gathered together in a place called in Hebrew Armageddon, to fight against God when he returns. Wow. And so we see that they had been working for years before the plagues for the sole purpose of working against God through his people. So they had the power instead of the Bible being the centerpiece, tradition took its place. And so God had to do what he did. And in so doing, we are displayed his love, his mercy, his grace. And well in advance, he's giving us a warning so that we can respond to it and be saved. By the way, it won't be easy, but it's possible. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Well, there's one more plague. That's the seventh angel pours out his bowl, verse 17, into the air. And a loud voice comes out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, I like this, you say it with me, it is done. Whoa, it's just like Jesus on the cross. It is finished. The seventh plague, it is done. Remember, seven is complete. And throughout Revelation, there are seven churches, seven trumpets, seven plagues, the seven branch candlestick, the seven loaves of bread on the bread of presence table. Seven, complete. When that's over, there's nothing else. It is done. And there was noise and thunder and lightning, and there was great earthquake, such a mighty and great earthquake as has not occurred since man were on the earth. Now the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nation fell. And great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of his fierceness, of his wrath. Verse 20, and then every single island fled away, and the mountains were not found, and great hail from heaven fell upon men, each hailstone weighing of a talent. And then it says, men blaspheme God because of the plague of hail, since the plague was exceedingly great. Wow, the gospel in the seven last plagues. We clearly see the angels testify to God's fairness, righteousness, his judgments are correct. And then we see three separate times they blaspheme God and refuse to repent. And then we see that they spent all this time gathering people together to fight against God, to fight against his people, to fight against the truths. In fact, let me say, not only fight against his truths, I'll be more specific, to fight against his commandments, who were instituted in the Garden of Eden at creation on the seventh day. And so, friends, here's the gospel in the seven last plagues. Now, I want to close with an appeal. Now, I'm going to read from Revelation 6. And here's what it says at verse 14. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up. And every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the commanders, and the mighty men, and every slave, and every free man, hid themselves in the caves and the rocks of the mountain, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come. And who is able to stand? Well, friends, those who have accepted Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior, those who, like me, came out of Babylon when I was introduced to all of this material and saw that that's what God desired me to do. But the ones that do not come out are the ones that cry out to the caves and the rocks and the mountains to fall on them and hide them from the presence of the Lamb who sits on the throne. the very one that saved us from sin, from death, and gave us eternal life. We would hide? Oh, God forbid, my friend, don't hesitate to make that decision. If you haven't, if you have, stay strong. Keep reading your Bible every day and praying so that God can fortify you as we move towards these momentous occasions that will be taking place shortly. Let me pray for us. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for the warnings that you give us, for the explanations we receive, for us being absolutely sure that you don't make mistakes. You know what you're doing. Even the angels testify. And help us to be on the right side, Lord, please. And so bless each one of us. For those who need to come out of her, my people, bring them out. For those that are already out, truly convert them, Lord. Because that's the key. Not that we're out necessarily, but that Jesus is our personal Lord and Savior. Make it happen, Lord, and keep each one safe and healthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless, friends, and we'll see you next week.
To heaven's shore, I journey onward.
Amen and amen. Pastor Neary, thank you so very much for that inspiring message today. We really appreciate the thoughts and the insights that we continue to gain from looking at the book of Revelation. And we want to thank you for joining us today. And we want to, of course, invite you to be with us again on next week. Let us know your thoughts, your prayers, prayer requests. We look forward to hearing from you and seeing you again soon. Have a wonderful day.
Through toil and tempest raging, for heaven's shore I fix my compass toward that holy land. I'll see my Savior falling on my knees before Him. On heaven's shore, I'll see my Savior.